Hello, dear students. I am Akriti Lamba. I am a science teacher at Kendriya Vidyalaya. So, as you know, that in today's video, we are going to be discussing and simplifying the chapter How Do Organisms Reproduce? Before I start doing that, I want to mention that the presentation that I have used here, this I will be attaching in the description box below so that you can download it as per your future needs. So, let's get started. How do organisms reproduce? Well, that is something that we'll eventually learn, but before that, I have a question. Why do organisms reproduce? What is reproduction and why is it so important that all organisms, be it a plant, be it an insect, be it an animal, be it even human beings for that matter, why do all of these living beings, they undergo this process? So if we go by definition, reproduction is a biological process by which an organism can produce individuals or offsprings of its own kind. So it is that process by which every living being can produce a new living being which is of the same kind, that means which is of the same species. But again, the question still remains unanswered, that why is it so important? What are the advantages of reproduction that makes it so important that we have a complete chapter devoted to it? So let's quickly study those three advantages. First of all, it is essential for the survival of species on Earth. So we know that our Earth comprises of millions or thousands of species, and all of us, all the living beings, we are mortal. At one day, or sooner or later, we have to die. So when we die, and if we do not reproduce, then the individuals of our species will eventually finish. So the species will not be existing any further if reproduction stops. The second one is, it ensures the continuity of life on Earth. Now, what do we mean by continuity of life? Today we have diverse forms of living beings on the planet. But say suppose if all the living beings stop reproduction, then in that case, after a point, let's assume 100 years or maybe 200 years, when all the living beings have died, at that point there will not be any life on Earth. So in order to make sure that Earth is still the living planet, reproduction needs to happen. And the third one is that it ensures the passing on of similar characters from the parents to the offspring. By the process of reproduction, the traits or the characters are being passed on from parent to the next generation, that is the offspring. So if reproduction does not happen, the characters or the traits from the parent generation will not be transferred to the offspring generation. So again, all these three are the important advantages of reproduction. Now, I told you that reproduction is carried out by all the living organisms, which means that such diverse organisms are undergoing the process. No wonder it is going to have varied forms or varied modes. So let's try to understand and categorize them. For the ease of understanding, we have grouped them into asexual reproduction and sexual reproduction. Now, what are these asexual and sexual stand for? So, asexual reproduction basically means that mode of reproduction where only one parent is involved. That means only a single individual will be giving rise to a new offspring. Considering that there's only one parent involved, this is a simpler or a less complex process. It is going to be consuming less time, less energy, and it is exhibited or shown by simpler organisms. Lastly, one of the most important features is that the offsprings or the progeny that is produced by asexual reproduction, that is actually an exact carbon copy of the parent. That means all the characters which were present in the parent, they are present in the offspring also. Such offsprings, which are exact copies, are known as clones. So this was about asexual mode of reproduction. What is sexual reproduction? This is exact contrary of the same. Here, both the parents, that is a male, that's your father, and a female, that is the mother, are involved. Because two beings are involved, here it is a complex process, more time consuming, more energy consuming, and it is shown by higher organisms. One of the most important features here is that DNA recombination takes place. So DNA recombination is something that we'll be dealing with on with the next segment and the next chapter. But just to give a brief idea, DNA or the deoxyribonucleic acid, which is the genetic material present in our chromosomes or nucleus, that comes from the male parent and the female parent. So in sexual reproduction, the offspring or the child is going to be comprising of DNA from the parent also, from the father also, and from the mother also. So in such cases where DNA has come from two different sources, it is going to recombine and then only form the offspring. So this process is known as DNA recombination. And the offspring that is produced contains the mix of characters of both the parents. So this is sexual reproduction. Further, if we try to study, asexual reproduction and sexual reproduction have their own types. Asexual reproduction can be categorized into six different categories: fission, fragmentation, regeneration, budding, vegetative propagation, and spore formation. So these are the six categories in which we can divide asexual reproduction. And that is our topic for today's class also. We will be dealing with asexual mode of reproduction. Sexual mode of reproduction we'll talk about in the next class or the next video. So beginning with the asexual modes, the first one is the mode of reproduction followed by the simplest living being. Amoeba, as we know, is a protozoan. It is a unicellular organism. That means it is a single-celled organism, which is responsible for all its life processes, including reproduction. So again, I pose a question here. How does amoeba with this single cell, with this microscopic single cell, reproduce? So the answer here is by the process of fission. Fission in biology means the splitting or the division of the parent cell into two or more daughter cells. Now, I mentioned two or more. As a result, fission can also be classified into two categories, where the parent cell is dividing into exactly two copies. So if it divides into two daughter cells, it is called binary fission. And if it divides into more number of daughter cells, any number, more than two, that is going to be called multiple fission. Now, why are we studying this separately? Because binary fission is observed in a lot of cells. So let's take the case of amoeba only here. We have the amoeba cell. The first step is the cell gets elongated, the nucleus gets elongated in size. The next step is it begins to divide, as you can see. And finally, the nucleus has divided, the cytoplasm has divided, and the plasma membrane has now begun to divide. Eventually, if you see, this gets separated from here and you finally get two daughter cells. So this is the process of binary fission. The exact same process is followed by paramecium as well, where division happens along this plane, this transverse plane. And in the end, you get two daughter paramecia. So this was about binary fission. Next we have to talk about is multiple fission. Students, in case you feel that I'm going slightly fast in between the transition of two modes, you can always pause the video. Multiple fission is very similar to binary fission. What happens here is that there is this single cell. This cell and the nucleus here, the nucleus divides repeatedly to form multiple daughter nuclei. This was exactly what was happening in binary fusion also, just that there only one time division happened into two. Here, division has happened multiple times. And the outer wall here is called a cyst. Why? Because the cell membrane of this cell has developed into a thick coat to protect the inner constituents. This cyst is formed. Later on, this nuclei will gather some cytoplasm and eventually form daughter cells. These daughter cells do not come out of the cyst as long as the cyst wall ruptures. It is a thick coating. Now, why is this thick coating present? That is because of presence of unfavorable conditions. What do we mean by unfavorable conditions? Unfavorable means conditions which are not supporting the growth or development of daughter cells. For example, let's assume that there is no water or moisture around. So the daughter cells will get dehydrated. Similarly, if oxygen is absent or there are extremes of temperature. So in those cases, the daughter cells will not be able to survive properly, and we call them unfavorable conditions. The cyst wall will prevent or protect all these daughter cells from such conditions. And the moment conditions become favorable back again, the cyst wall ruptures, sorry. So this is whatever I explained is written here. You can have a look. The next thing that I mentioned was about fission in amoeba. It is a peculiar case. Reason being, normally, under normal conditions, it is undergoing the process of binary fission, that is splitting into two daughter cells. But sometimes what happens is when conditions are not favorable, it undergoes the process of multiple fission. So amoeba is an example of both. But again, unfavorable conditions have to be mentioned. So with this, the first mode of reproduction is over. The next is budding. What is budding? It is commonly observed in organisms like Hydra and yeast. Yeast is another household common name. It is a unicellular fungi. So what is budding? A small bud. Bud is nothing but an outgrowth, something which grows outside of the skin. So the outgrowth or the bud, it starts developing on the body of the parent. This outgrowth will take the nutrients, will use all the life processes from the parent cell and start growing in size. Eventually, it develops completely into a new individual. The moment it attains maturity, it detaches itself from the parent body. So let's do this with the help of a diagram. In Hydra, see, this is what a Hydra looks like. Here you have a small, tiny bud. This bud starts developing by consuming nutrients and other things from the parent. It has now started developing. It will grow in size and start maturing into a new individual. The moment maturation takes place, it is going to divide from here and fall off and start its life as a new individual. Whereas in cases of yeast, sometimes what happens is that the new bud that was formed, the new organism that was formed, this has not completely fallen off. So it chooses to stick to the parent wall still, and again, so the next bud also sticks, and eventually what you get is a chain of buds. See, biology is a science of exception. There is nothing known as which is permanent. So budding, the bud may or may not follow from the parent body. So that brings us to the end of the second mode of asexual reproduction. The third mode is fragmentation. What is fragmentation? The name itself tells us that here there are fragments which are formed. What are fragments? Fragments means small, small pieces. So as you can see in this diagram, what is happening is that there is this large cell body. This breaks down into three fragments here. And each of these fragments has the capability to again regenerate and form the parent cell. So this process is known as fragmentation. This occurs in multicellular organisms, but the organisms which have a simple body organization. For example, algae. The picture that I've shown here is of Spirogyra. It's a type of algae. The parent body breaks into fragments and each fragment develops into an entirely new organism. Very easy, very simple, right? So that was about fragmentation. The next mode is regeneration. This is very interesting. So regeneration, before I start off, I want to ask you, where in your daily life or where have you seen regeneration happening? It happens all around you, that I can assure you. Just try to think where it happens. And if you can't, then just let me give you a hint. So now I think you can all remember that for a lizard, what happens is, if in case due to some reason the tail gets lost, so what is going to happen is it gets broken, or it gets damaged, or it is lost. In those cases, the lizard is going to regrow or regain the tail back. Now, how does this happen? This is because it has certain tissues present here which will help to regain the lost body part. Now, when the organism is regenerating in order to repair the body, it is known as reparative regeneration. But when the organism is doing so in order to reproduce, it is known as reproductive regeneration. So here, this is the example of planaria. What you see is the organism, just like fragmentation, it got divided into three different pieces, and each piece has the capability to again grow back into a new individual. Right? In lizards, if you see, the broken tail cannot give rise to the entire lizard back again. But in planaria, if you see, even the tail part can give rise to the entire organism. That is the difference between reparative and reproductive regeneration. So you can read this if you want. Next up, I told you that regeneration and fragmentation are very similar. In both of them, you have fragments or pieces being broken, and each of the piece gives rise to a new individual. But what is the difference between the two? There have to be a major difference. So here, if you see, fragmentation is a mode of reproduction only, whereas regeneration can be used for repair purposes also. Second thing, and the most important point of difference, is that fragmentation is more commonly seen in plants, whereas regeneration is more commonly seen in animals. So this is the most important point of difference between the two. Apart from this, fragmentation happens in certain fixed organisms, whereas regeneration happens in almost all living organisms. And on this note, I have another question for you. Where in the human body do we observe regeneration? I can assure you it happens in your body as well. But which organ undergoes regeneration when it gets damaged? So just find that out, and I'll wait for your answers in the comments below. Alright, so moving forward to the next section, the next mode of reproduction. Can you guess which one is it? What do we see on the slide? We see a bread, and we see certain white deposits here and certain grey patches here. So what are these? Well, if you keep a bread aside in the kitchen for about a week or maybe about 15 days, what you see is, you see certain white and grey patches on it. Why do these? Where are these coming from? That is because we say that the bread has gone stale. That's what we say, that bread kharab ho gayi hai. But wo kharab hui kaise? Because there are certain microbes which have started developing on this. How? This process is known as spore formation. Spores are microscopic round structures which are produced by certain fungi and bacteria. Now, these spores, also called as the reproductive units, they are present in a sac-like structure which is known as sporangium. So you can see here a sac is present that is known as sporangium. This sporangium contains hundreds and millions of spores. Each of these spores has the capability to again rise up and form the fungal structure. So this process is very similar to multiple fission, where also you had a outer covering and millions of cells inside. So similar structure is present here in the form of sporangium and spore. When the conditions become favorable, the spore sac is going to burst and each of the spore will reproduce to form a new fungus. This helps the organism to tolerate extreme conditions. So that was about spore formation, and this brings us to the last topic of the video, that is the sixth method of asexual reproduction, vegetative propagation. Vegetative propagation is a means of asexual reproduction in plants. In plants, new organisms can arise from vegetative parts of the parent. Now, what are vegetative parts? Does the vegetable here mean vegetative parts? No. By vegetative part, I mean that any other part which is not the reproductive part. So in plants, what you have is the flower, as we have studied in previous classes, is the reproductive organ of the plant. It contains stamen and pistil. So flower comprises of the reproductive organ. Apart from the flower, anything on the plant will form a part of its vegetative part. So for example, vegetative parts can be the roots, the stem, and the leaf. Anything but not the flower. So the first part is vegetative propagation through roots. All of us have, I think, in 6th or 7th studied about modified roots. So which modified root is being shown on the slide? Well, this is a sweet potato, or as we commonly know it as shakarkandi. So if you have seen the look of it, you have certain depressions present. Each of these depressions have the capability to regenerate buds, and these buds will eventually form a new plant. So buds are present on the roots. When planted in soil, these buds give rise to new plants under favorable conditions. You provide it with nutrients, you provide it with water, and eventually a new plant will grow. So that's how sweet potato grows. If you want, you can also try this at home if you have interest in plants. Okay, so moving forward, next one, vegetative propagation through stem. Now, how does this happen? Which is the most common modified stem that we use, that we eat for that matter? I think each and every one of us in the Indian household use this. It is the potato. So here you have tiny, small, little buds, right? We used to call them eyes. So these eyes have the capability to regenerate and form buds. And these buds, if planted, can form the entire plant. You can even ask your mothers about it. If the potato is left in open for about a month or about 15-20 days, or if you just moisten it, you know, sprinkle some water on it and leave it, after a few days you will observe certain green buds coming out of it. So this is something that you can do at your homes as well. Another modified stem that we can use is ginger or adrak. So again, buds appear on the stem, and when these are planted in the soil, a new plant can be grown. And similarly is the vegetative propagation through leaves, where new buds are formed at the leaf margins. And these buds, when they develop, they fall off. And if again they fall on the moist ground, if you plant them, you can form a new individual. The picture that I've shown here is from the bryophyllum plant. This is the most common example for vegetative propagation through leaves. So this was all about natural vegetative propagation. That is how vegetative propagation happens normally in the nature. Apart from this, even we can perform vegetative propagation by human intervention. That is when we use the plant, the root or the shoot or the leaf we maybe cut it, we combine it with something else, and then we plant it. So if human intervention has been put in, then it is called as artificial vegetative propagation. Too much details I would suggest are not required, so let's not get into that. It is done mostly for ornamental plants, for example rose. So the last topic, the small little thing that's mentioned in your book in a box, is known as tissue culture. What are tissues? Tissues are nothing but a group of cells. What is culture? When you grow something in an artificial medium, that is known as culturing. So tissue culture refers to the growth of tissues in an artificial but suitable growth medium. That is known as tissue culture. This artificial growth medium, normally the medium that we take is agar medium, A-G-A-R, agar medium. So this nutrient medium is kept under aseptic conditions. Aseptic means conditions free from any kind of germs or microbe. Sanitized conditions basically. So again, this is also used for ornamental plants. Why are we doing this? So tissue culture is basically culturing of plants in a lab. But why are we doing that? Because it is a fast process. It is less time consuming. The plants, it is less space consuming. The plants that are formed, they are disease free. And lastly, the plants can be grown irrespective of the weather, the temperature, and the outside conditions. Reason being, they are grown in a lab. Now, how do we do it? The practical application of it is known as micropropagation. What you're doing here is basically, you take out the top apical meristem. You would have done this in ninth, the top growing tissue of the plant. So you take out this apical meristem and you plant it in a growth medium of agar. What will happen is this meristem will divide rapidly to form a mass of cells. That mass of cells is known as callus, C-A-L-L-U-S, callus. That mass of cells is undifferentiated, that is, the meristem just repeatedly divided, and then eventually those cells will take up different functions and form small little plantlets, which later on can be planted in the soil. So basically, आपने tissue लिया, tissue को growth medium में डाला, growth medium में उसने अपने आप को divide किया, callus form हुआ, फिर वो callus से अपने different functions लेगा, and it is going to finally form plants. So micropropagation and tissue culture are interrelated. So with this, students, we end the topic of asexual reproduction. Quickly getting back to the first slide again, significance of asexual reproduction is that the characters can be transferred from the parents to the offspring more efficiently. Reason being, clones were formed. There's a short generation time, energy efficient, and I told you clones are formed. But there, you can't have all advantages, right? There have to be some disadvantages also. So disadvantages are, recombination of genes is not possible. I told you that's possible only for sexual mode of reproduction. Second, the population here tends to be genetically stable. What do I mean by genetically stable? So if recombination is not happening, that means जो कैरेक्टर एक बार पेरेंट में थे, ओनली दे आर बीइंग ट्रांसफर्ड टू द नेक्स्ट जनरेशन. देर इज नो स्कोप ऑफ एनी ऑल्टरेशन, एनी एडिशन और एनी मॉडिफिकेशन. सो द जेनेटिक कॉम्पोजिशन रिमेन्स द सेम. एंड द लास्टली, म्यूटेशंस एंड अबनॉर्मैलिटीज आर ट्रांसफर्ड डायरेक्टली टू द ऑफस्प्रिंग. सो इफ एट ऑल देर इज एनी अबनॉर्मैलिटी, एनी डिजीज इन द पेरेंट, इट विल बी ट्रांसफर्ड टू द ऑफस्प्रिंग नो मैटर व्हाट. So here, this is a very major disadvantage. So students, this brings us to the end of the chapter. Sorry. This brings us to the end of today's topic, that is asexual reproduction. And so I hope that I was able to explain to you the topics well and you've understood. Thank you so much for watching. And for your assessment, I have put in some questions here. So you can go through them. Have a look at the answers, and I would really appreciate if you write the answers in the comment section below so that you can also discuss and I can also verify if those are correct or not. So the first one, which of the following organism reproduces asexually through fragmentation? फंगस, प्रोटोजोआ, एल्गी, और द फोर्थ वन बीइंग प्लांट. सेकेंड क्वेश्चन इज विच ऑफ द फॉलोइंग रिप्रोड्यूसेस एसेक्सुअली थ्रू इट्स लीव्स. यू हैव टू चूज विच ऑफ द फॉलोइंग डज दैट. So the third question is the mass of undifferentiated cells during micropropagation is called what? Thallus, callus, plantlets or clones? The next one, the round structures which help the fungus to tide over difficult situations are called what? So you have to choose between one of the four options. And the fifth question is which of the following statements about spores is incorrect? So there are three correct statements and one incorrect. Choose the incorrect one. They are light in weight, they germinate to give rise to zygote, they are surrounded by a hard protective outer coat, they survive unfavorable conditions. So students, that brings us to the end of the video. I have given you five questions and I hope to get answers for all of them. Thank you so much for watching and I hope that I was able to make you understand the topic. So you can always leave your feedbacks in the comment section below. I hope that you liked it. Thank you so much.